you ever noticed a finger or thumb that bends in a strange way? Or maybe you've had difficulty straightening or bending one of your own fingers? If so, then you might have seen or even experienced a finger deformity. So today I'm going to look at five of the most common finger and thumb deformities that we see in clinical practice. Swan neck, Boutonniere, mallet finger, Dupuytren's contracture, and the Z-shaped deformity of the thumb. I'm going to look at what causes them, how they affect movement, and the treatment options available. And if you have a finger problem that's not really a deformity, but you think something else might be going on, then stick around to the end of the video because I'll briefly cover some of the other finger problems that we commonly see. I'm Stephen Bunting. I'm a specialist MSK physiotherapist working in the UK. Welcome to my channel, where we discuss the common MSK conditions that affect everyday people and the evidence-based treatments that can help. Okay, so I'm going to organise this video by taking each condition in turn. So if you know what condition you might have, then skip ahead to the relevant section by looking at the chapters or in the video description. But if you're not quite sure which of these finger or thumb deformities you might have, then I'll quickly put up a picture of each, and then you can then skip ahead to the relevant section. So let's start with mallet finger, as it's one of the most common finger deformities that we see. It happens after an injury where the fingertip suddenly catches against something or gets stubbed against an object or is hit by an object, commonly when catching a ball awkwardly, where the fingertip is suddenly forced into a bent position. As a result of the injury, the end of the extensor tendon is pulled off the bone, so it can no longer do its job of straightening the end of the finger. And it can also happen in the thumb, but less commonly. So your finger or thumb will end up looking like this, where the tip droops down and you can't straighten it without help from the other hand. Now, I've covered mallet finger in depth in another video, which I'll link to up here, or you can find it in the description. And in that video, I cover the treatment regime in detail. So if you think you might have a mallet injury, then go and check that out. Dupuytren's contracture is a genetic disorder which causes firm lumps and sometimes bands of tight tissue to develop in the palm and sometimes the fingers of the hand. It's completely harmless, and its only symptom is this thickened tissue, but sometimes that tissue can tighten and cause the adjacent finger to bend. It usually affects the little and ring fingers, but it can affect any finger. So if you have a hand with some thickened lumps or bands in the palm and fingers that look like this, that you can't straighten, but you can bend them okay, then it's likely that you have a Dupuytren's contracture. Now, I've also covered Dupuytren's in detail, including all the different treatment options, in two videos, which I'll also link to up here and in the description. So if you think you might have this condition, then go and check those videos out. Okay, so as you can see, a swan neck deformity is where the middle joint of the finger, the PIP joint, bends backwards the wrong way, a position called hyperextension. And then the end joint, the DIP joint, adopts a flex position. So overall, the finger resembles the position of a swan's neck. And if you have a swan neck deformity, then you might struggle with gripping, making a fist, and with fine dexterity activities. The PIP joint might also snap or flick suddenly from the hyperextended position to the flex position when you try and make a fist. Swan necks can be painful, but not usually. It's more of a finger movement problem than a painful problem in most cases. There can be many causes of swan neck deformity, but the most common ones are as a result of rheumatoid arthritis, due to an injury, or having hypermobile joints, such as in hypermobility syndrome or Ehlers-Danlos syndrome. And with all these causes, the result is the same: an imbalance in the way the extensor tendon works. essentially a set of ligaments on the flexor side of the PIP joint, collectively called the volar plate, becomes lax, which then causes the joint to hyperextend. The volar plate can become lax due to a finger injury where the PIP joint becomes forcibly bent backwards, but it can also happen due to the erosive effects of chronic inflammation like we see in rheumatoid arthritis. Now, if you've had a swan neck deformity for a long time and it's not bothering you, then it's probably best left alone. But if it happened recently, then there is a scope for treatment and recovery. And that's by using a specific splinting regime to help encourage healing of the volar plate. You're going to need to use a splint which holds the PIP joint in a slightly bent position, and you're going to need to wear it for about 8 weeks. What you're trying to do is keep the volar plate off stretch so it can heal in a better position. I'll put a link in the description for a suitable splint, but I would advise seeing a hand therapist as every swan neck is different and it's best to get a professional opinion. And if you've had a swan neck deformity for a while, perhaps you've tried the splinting regime and it hasn't worked for you, or you have joint hypermobility or rheumatoid arthritis, then you can choose to use the splint for the long term. Not all the time, but just when you're active with your hands, and this will help with finger function. So it should stop any snapping or flicking of the finger and generally improve your finger movement while you're wearing it. But finally, if it's a real problem for you or if it's painful, then you might need to see a hand surgeon, as there are a few different surgical options out there depending on your individual situation. A Boutonniere deformity is pretty much the opposite of a swan neck. So now, instead of hyperextension of the PIP joint, we have a bent position of the PIP. And instead of the DIP joint being flexed, as in a swan neck, it's now hyperextended. A Boutonniere deformity is caused by an injury to part of the extensor tendon called the central slip. This part of the tendon is responsible for straightening the PIP joint. And without it, the PIP joint falls into a bent position and you can't straighten the finger. The injury essentially creates a hole in the central slip, which the head of the proximal phalanx bone can push through, a bit like a button pushing through a buttonhole, which is exactly where it gets its name from, because boutonnier means buttonhole in French. Now, if you've just had this injury, then it's usually treated in a splint, which holds the PIP joint in a straight position for at least 8 weeks, and it must be worn all the time, day and night, in order to give the central tendon every chance of healing. Whilst in the splint, you will be encouraged to move and exercise the MCP or knuckle joint and the end joint, the DIP joint. But the middle joint, the PIP joint, must be kept straight all the time. The type of splint used for this injury is called a caper splint, and while you can buy variations of this splint online, it's better to have one custom made for you, because that ensures that it fits your individual finger properly. So because of this, and because the splinting regime needs to be followed very carefully, the whole treatment process is best done under the supervision of a hand therapist in order to give your finger every chance to heal properly. Because if it doesn't heal, then you're going to need to see a hand surgeon about the option of tendon repair. And if you've left it too long after the injury, and particularly if your PIP joint has become stiff so it doesn't move anymore, then your options are going to be limited. Your choices are now to either leave it alone and cope with the finger as it is, or to discuss your options with a hand surgeon. And that's likely to mean PIP joint fusion or joint replacement. Okay, so the last deformity I'm going to discuss is the Z-shaped deformity of the thumb. And you can clearly see where it gets its name from. So this is caused by arthritic changes at the thumb CMC joint. So it's usually something that has slowly progressed over the years. What happens is that the arthritic CMC joint becomes unstable. As the joint surfaces erode and the ligaments become lax, the metacarpal starts to migrate out to the side, causing something that we call squaring of the thumb base. And as the base of the metacarpal moves further outwards, the other end of the metacarpal, the head end, moves inwards to compensate, a bit like a seesaw. And this then causes further compensation reactions at the MCP joint, which has to hyperextend in order to keep the thumb in a functional position so you can use it. So a Z-shaped deformity is basically a series of joint compensation reactions driven by arthritis. Treatment-wise, if any of the joints are painful, then they can be treated with topical gels, joint supports and joint injections. A thumb-based splint can sometimes be helpful, but it will need to be one like this that doesn't cause pressure against a squared thumb base. I'll put a link in the description to this splint. Sometimes though, a custom-made heat mouldable splint is the best option, as it is shaped to the individual thumb position. This can be provided by a hand therapist, but you can also buy do-it-yourself kits, and I'll put some links in the description. But while these treatments can sometimes help with the pain, unfortunately, there is nothing you can do to change the Z-shaped position of the thumb without surgery. Okay, so that's about it. But as promised, I'll quickly mention some of the other common finger and thumb problems that can also cause issues with finger and thumb movement. First is trigger finger and trigger thumb. So in this condition, you get a clicking, a sticking, or a locking of the finger or thumb when you bend it. So this can cause a temporary finger or thumb deformity, but it usually snaps back out again, or triggers, if you force it straight. And it can be very painful. Now, I've covered trigger digits in detail in another video, which I'll link to in the description. Osteoarthritis and rheumatoid arthritis can both also cause finger and thumb deformities, usually bony lumps and bumps over the joints. So if your hand looks like this or this, then look in the description for my other videos which compare rheumatoid and osteoarthritis, and also another more detailed video about nodal hand arthritis. And finally, if you've got any other type of lump, bump, swelling or cyst in the hand, then you've guessed it, I've covered it in another video, also linked to in the description. And if you do have any other type of finger or thumb deformity that I've not mentioned, then let me know in the comments. I've listed some of the less common ones here. And if I've not covered it in my back catalogue, then it's probably on the to-do list for a future video. Okay, well that's about it. I do hope the video has been helpful. Thanks very much for watching, and bye for now.